But anyway, I just want to go over the basics. So we need more hunters. We've got four hunters now. One of us has to be in the box, so that got us down to three hunters. We would invite everyone and anyone to come and join in. And I'm just going to demonstrate maybe some of the things that we do and tell you some stories and that sort of thing. This here is a box by itself. Just wanted to show that to you. We'll get that as soon as it comes on. This box here runs 15 seconds out of every minute. I think it's 300 milliwatts or something like that. So we don't use it for our normal mobile fox hunt, but I have had it at the end of the fox hunt, and it's on a different frequency than a normal hunt. So I have had it at the end and hide it too, so when they get there, the guys that get there already have something to hunt. So that's what that is, and like I say, you use it once in a while, there it is. So that's MO1. In Morse code, I can't copy that, but it's supposed to be my call sign. So it's 15 seconds. And the reason for that, because you're a close-in hunt, I don't want to be alone very long because it gives you too much time to get there. So it's short duration. This is our fox box that we normally use out in the field, and some of us have got our own, but we'll have it in this box if we use this one. And that'll be what we're looking for. A lot of times in our mobile hunts, we actually look for the car. You know, Mike's hiding out there, and he's in his gray truck, and I see his gray truck, and I'm going to assume that box is there. But most of the time, it will be. Sometimes it won't be. So it just depends on how much time I want to put into the hunt that particular day. We would go to, I would set it down the road 2 or 3 miles, and then leave that box, because it'll be automatic, and you'll have to find that box, and my truck won't be there. That makes it a little tougher, because we get in a bad habit of hunting the guy's vehicle, because we know who's hiding. So put the box out, and it's a different story. It gets to be a little tougher. So that's what this one is. It puts out 2 watts max, I think. This is called a pecan controller. And you can set it up to run however you want to. If you run a minute on, a minute off, minute on, 5 minutes off, you put your own call sign in and everything. These are about 65, 70 bucks for one of these already built. I got one. That's an old one. We'll see if I have a new one. Here's what they look like now, the controller, if you'd order one from, what's the guy,
Bionics.
You can order the cable and everything. You know, it costs you a little more, but he's got a lot nicer cables than what I can build. I have to get somebody to build mine. But that's the controller, it'll come in and buy, already built, maybe around $70. It's good to have, if you're going to do fox hunting very much, it's good to have one because you can set it out and practice. You can set it out, or have somebody set it out for you to go on. So it is good to have one. So that's kind of how we do that. We originally started out, and you still do this if you want to participate and be the box. You can do it on your mobile unit and just talk. You can just key the mic and talk for a minute. Or key the mic and say, hey, this is the fox. At the end of the minute, say, give your call sign and clear off. Next group, do it again. It gets to be boring after about an hour of that, but you can do it. But we normally run this here. So that's what we're looking for. We're looking for that signal from either that transmitter. The other thing about the transmitter is you can take the rubber duck off. I'll put a 4-element beam on it, headed back to the start. Because the rules of the fox hunt is you have to get signal back to the start point. They have to be able to hear you. So if you're out with that on a rubber duck 15 miles away, guess what? They're not going to hear you. So I'll put it on a 4-element beam headed back back that way. And I mean, yeah, go ahead.
Does it have to be mounted on the ground, or can it be up in the air, or what's the rules as far as?
You don't have any rules on whether it's up in the air or in the ground. I think some of them do. We never did do that. Actually, we had a, since you mentioned it, we had a kid that hid one in a plastic container, and he pulled on ropes up in a treetop.
That was down at Williams, wasn't it?
Down at Williams.
Yes, I remember that.
So it's kind of fun not to have those limiting rules, because it does open up some things there. So that, right now, our rule, I think, states that it's got to be handicap accessible, because basically Keith is handicapped. And we, you know, what I do on that, like say I would hide this, I have this transmitting to get you in here, to get you to the cemetery I'm at. But then I may have this hid where you've got to walk to it. But Keith, when he gets there, he's done. He don't have to find that. So that's kind of how we work that. So we can still have some fun and do some different things. But when Keith's hunting, he just has to get there. We take it based on mileage only. It's not a time thing, because we started out kind of doing the time thing. And you have a tendency to drive over your handheld on the car or the truck, and you'll find it down the highway when you go back and look for it and things like that. It's kind of exciting when you do this first few times, and we have a tendency to forget things. Another thing is that we kind of don't like the time thing because of the breaking the speed limit or whatever, you know. So it's just better, we think. Cincinnati does it on a time basis, but we think it's better to do it on a mileage basis. So it gives you plenty of time. Our 2 hour hunt, our hunts are basically 2 hours, and we'll call it off right at that point. If he starts late, we'll call it. We'll just still give you 2 hours, unless you say you can't find it, you don't want to hunt anymore. So kind of flexible on that. As long as you'll call in and let us know you're not going to hunt anymore, then we go eat, which, you know. But anyway, that's what we're hunting. And that's basically how we do the box. I'll go ahead and unplug this one.
Are these on the same frequency?
No. This is on 144.82. That's on 145.
Well, how does the hunter know when you switched over?
I won't have him hunt this until he finds me. This will be on. This will be on. He just has to switch frequencies. So he's hunting this frequency. He's hunting 146.565 to get there. And then, but like I say, I don't put this out that often. If I do, it's a different frequency. He can still, he can get there. Let's say you get there, and you know the others aren't there. I say, go ahead and hunt the little fox.
Oh, yeah.
You just
extra hunt.
Yeah, it's just an extra hunt.
Okay,
it's
just, part of it.
No, it's not.
Close to identifying that.
No, you're it's just an extra. So that's. Like I say, most of the time we don't use that. Nobody else uses that. Basically, you're hunting 146.565. So, like I say, you can have signal to, the signal's got to get back to that church where you can hear it. We make sure everybody hears it. Okay, so in the worst setup, you still got to hear it. Or, you know, if his setup's no good, then of course he can't play. But if two out of three are hearing it, you're probably going to say, you know, you need to fix your setup. But the thing of it is, though, I could be in my mobile unit that's going to put out 50 watts, hooked to a 4L beam at Bolo, headed to that church site. And I could give you 20 minutes of that on 50 watts. And I'm going to tell you, after 20 minutes, I'm cutting the power cord. So after 20 minutes, I'm going to go to that Fox box. You're probably going to be in a place that you're not going to even hear that. But you've had 20 minutes to get buried and sing. Just keep going that way until you start picking it up again, is the philosophy of that. I don't like that. Some of us do that. We've done that a few times, but it seems to kind of aggravate the people that are hunting if they don't hear the fox. You know, they want to hear, and I've been there. I know the feeling. It's like, and I'm sure I should be hearing that thing. I'm almost out in county. I can hear it this time. You know, is it off? You know, so we try. I try not to do very much of that, but we do it once in a while. Most of the time, if I'm the fox, I'm going to put plenty of signal out there, because it's hard to find you with too much signal, as That's too little signal. You get too much out there, you're 3 miles away, you're getting full scale everywhere. If you don't have attenuator, you're not going to be able to knock it down. So the philosophy over the years, it's better that they hear it, you know, but we do it both ways. Just if you do go on, be prepared. Have your map. We take maps. Something like this. Got plastic coating on that. And use a grease pencil. Take your bearings, transfer your bearings to the map. Get your bearing that way. It don't make any difference. Once I get a bearing from the start, I know he's that way. He's in Springville area. And if I get close enough, you're going to start hearing him again. Even if you don't hear him for a while. So don't get excited. Unless he has trouble with the transmitter. You know, something happens there. But that's a map and a compass is something that you should have. Don't have to have. I mean, don't go if you don't have one. I think Keith more or less hunts. If it's up that way, we're going that way. If he gets to that road and found it towards that way, he's going that way. I don't really think he uses the map at all.
He does.
Does he use the map?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I didn't think he did.
Yeah, a couple times when me drove it with him. He'll pull out that map and he'll have his little map.
Okay. Okay, I was wrong. I didn't think he did.
Yeah.
And as close as you get to the end of the hunt, the less I use the map. I mean, you use it to point, but directly it's kind of like you got two choices. Either this way or that way. It's stronger this way. I'm going this way, you know. So that's kind of how that works. And if anybody's interested, then you know, maybe I could teach you something that would help you in what you how you want to operate. Me and Keith both have a four-element quad on the back of our vehicles.